Welcome to another edition of Viper's Voices, presented by Murphy Batista, LLP Personal Injury Lawyers. My guest this week, well, doesn't need much of an introduction, Marty Stein joins us. Marty, thanks for being here.
Thank you very much.
What a great time it is. Viper celebrating the 60th anniversary last Saturday. And, well, we go back in the archives and we chat with the alumni and people who have had some pretty strong impacts on the community. And, you know, for you, I mean, you're a local guy. How nice is it to be able to scout here and maybe talk about growing up here in the great, rich hockey history that this town has?
Yeah, I was very fortunate. I've lived my whole life here in Vernon, born and raised. Played my minor hockey here. I played my junior hockey here. I was very forced to play for my own hometown team. We were the Vernon Vikings, or sorry, the Vernon Essos my first year, and then 2 years with the Vernon Vikings before I went on to UBC and played there. It was great playing in the old rink there, and it was a lot of fun and a lot of good memories.
Well, and it's an amazing thing. We've started to think about the hockey history here in town a little bit more, and Don Klepp wrote, you know, the great book that sort of showcases everything, not just the junior hockey aspect, but just the game in general in this town. And you've been a part of the community forever. Have you been able to sort of track, you know, or put a finger on what makes the sport so popular and so impactful on a lot of people's lives here?
Well, for one, we live in Canada. You know, hockey's the number one sport in our great country. And our area, the Okanagan, like, we've had such great rivalries with Penticton and Kelowna and Kamloops when they were in the BCHL. And, you know, just being brought up in a hockey-rich, you know, valley itself, and that's what brings a lot of history.
There are so many great names that have sort of gone along with this as well. You know, the Holland brothers, and Ken's obviously had a great career, and the Gares, and I mean, I'm sure you've seen, and I'll miss a couple by accident, but some fantastic hockey names and people who've been able to make careers, I mean, yourself included in that. You've had a chance to obviously meet and grow with some of these people. Have you known from a beginning that, you know, these people were going to have successful careers in hockey, and it started early?
You never know what type of future people are going to have. You know, with the Hollands, I mean, they are, for example, Ken and his brother, they grew up in a home where sport was pushed, but there's a lot of discipline was pushed in that. And, you know, like Reinie Holland, he was very successful in that regard with minor hockey, minor baseball. You saw it in Ken when, you know, just the passion he had for those sports. The Gare brothers, you know, like Ernie and Danny and Maury, you know, they came in from Nelson. Ernie came in from there, and they have such a strong hockey history. They're the Price brothers. They came in from Quesnel. They just happened to settle here in Vernon. I know I'm missing a whole bunch of people, and because we've got such a great history with the junior team here and senior hockey itself, where players have stayed in here, in this valley, in this great town of ours, and made hockey their home, and made Vernon their home as well.
You spent a couple of junior years here playing, as you mentioned, the Essos and the Vikings. Did you always want to play junior hockey here growing up? Was that something that you strived for, or was it something that sort of happened to just manufacture itself for you?
Oh, that's probably the number one dream of every minor hockey player in Vernon. They want to play junior. I know when, for example, my Uncle Bob, he was part of the original Vernon Blades when they first started the BCJHL. I'd go to their games and I'd sit right beside the bench. I'd see them coming in. I thought, geez, that'd be great if I could be a part of that. You know, and it kind of gets etched in your head. And then, you know, going public skating before the juniors would come out and play, there was guys like Bob Mayer and Bob Powell and Lyle Brewer and these guys. They'd be playing, and I thought, I'd love to do that. And I got lucky. I got, you know, I was good enough to play here, and so I got, it was a great experience for me to play in my hometown.
What are some of your fondest memories from, you know, being on those teams, and was the moment you skated out there with the jersey on your back in front of your hometown family and friends, so what did that mean to you?
Well, I think you hit it on the nail there. You know, being with your family's up in the stands, all your friends are there. I had my girlfriend. Got to impress her and that. You know, things like that. But having friends and family in the stands, you know, it's just a great atmosphere. And back then, we were getting good crowds as well. I mean, the rink didn't hold that very many people, but when it was full, you know, they're right on top of you, and it just got the juices flowing.
And then let's talk about the Civic Arena. You know, it's had such history behind it, and you got a chance to obviously to play in it a lot. Rinks these days are quite differently designed, more spacious, more room. What was it like playing, you know, on that, in that environment on a night-to-night basis with the passionate fans that Vernon has?
Well, one thing, it was cold. It was every rink we went to, be it Kelowna, Penticton, I mean, they're still standing. And then we go to Merritt, and it's the exact same rink. And I still think that Merritt's one of the coldest rinks around. In the old one here, it was just cold. But once you got going, it's such a confined space and that, you know, you kind of forgot the cold. But those are the things that you remember about it.
You're known for being a scout. A lot of people obviously remember you from, you know, playing here. Not everybody knows that you had a career in between the scouting and the junior hockey. You mentioned before we hit record here that you were a teacher for a long time as well. Did you always want to do that? Was that a passion of yours to get involved and help the youth learn and help develop some people at that age?
You know what? Like I said before, I was very fortunate to play hockey in my hometown. I was very fortunate to be able to teach in my hometown. I taught for 32 years here. I taught everything under the sun when I first started, and my passion, my education was physical education and geography, and I ended up, you know, started my first 5 years at VSSS when it was just grade 11 and 12, and then 1986, it was forced transfer. They had a bunch of layoffs, blah, 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 and so I ended up at Fulton Secondary, and I taught there for 27 years, and back then, you were expected not just to be a teacher, you were expected to coach and help out intramurals, extramurals, and that. And I just loved coaching. I just loved being around the kids in that regard. My wife Tammy and I, we have three kids, two boys and a daughter. They all played. My boys played hockey, soccer, lacrosse, and my daughter played soccer. They were very good athletes. I got involved with them coaching. Now I've got seven grandkids, and they're kind of getting involved in that. So is it in my blood? I don't know. It's just the way my passion was. And I'm hoping I've passed it on to my kids as well.
How were you able to transition? Because when we've sort of done the history, you weren't a full-time scout to begin with. You were obviously a teacher at the same time as the time lapses sort of overlap with each other. How did you get involved with the scouting aspect of it? You mentioned coaching, and maybe that would have been an avenue for you in terms of the junior ranks or something. How did you sort of tie yourself in with the Red Wings on a scouting basis? And obviously that's worked out really well for you.
Well, we'd mentioned Ken Holland before. Ken Holland and me, we played minor hockey together since we were both age six. He's a year older. So every second year, we'd be playing on the same team, and we were good enough to play rep hockey. And so as I was teaching, Kenny was playing minor pro. He'd come back. We'd work at the summer hockey school here. And then once he became involved as a scout, and he became assistant general manager, he wanted to form a pro-am league. So we formed a pro-am league in the summer. And at that time, you know, we had four teams. We had all these pros coming in from all over the place, from Kamloops all the way to Penticton. It was a great league. It was a great starter league for these guys to get ready for their upcoming season. So we did that. And in 1996, Detroit needed a part-time guy in the area. Ken gave me the opportunity, and I rode with it. And I told you before, in 1997 and 98, Detroit wins the Stanley Cup, and I'm going, hey, this is pretty easy.
Yeah.
This is great. You know, so, and we won it again 2002, won it in 2008. So I was fortunate to be with such a great franchise. And, you know, as fate would have with any other team, you know, you have your highs and your lows. I've ridden the highs, I've ridden the lows, but in 25 years with the Red Wings, I can't complain. It's Kenny gave me the opportunity to do that, and I've ridden with it, and that's how it started.
And I love to ask the question, and I've asked you this on our radio broadcast before, but, you know, what makes this league, the BCHL, you know, special, or, you know, something that the NHL teams want to look at? When you're looking at players, is it the fact that you get extra looks at them? They call it a late bloomer league a little bit, where guys tend to be a little bit older. They're not necessarily drafted at their actual age limit. Usually it's a little bit later. But obviously lots of great players have come out of this league. What is it that sort of draws the attention of the NHL teams to this league?
Well, the one thing about the BCHL is, to me and a lot of other scouts as well, it's more or less in agreement. Players want to come to the BCHL because they know they are going to get scouted not only by the NHL but by colleges. When you're playing junior A hockey, the first thing you're looking at, I want to get a college education. That's what I want to do. If I can go play pro, that's just bonus. There's very few players in this league that have, you know, been first, second round picks and have gone on to wonderful careers in the NHL. Players want to come here. They know they're going to get scouted. Me as an NHL scout, I like watching those players, but I also like to watch them develop, because if you are drafted in the WHL, for example, in Major Junior, you have 2 years to sign that kid, okay? If you're drafted out of the Junior A and they end up going to college, you've got 4 years. You've got 4 years to have this kid, you know, grow and get better and get more skill, play against older players now. And that's why there's a lot of players who at college have jumped from the BCHL or the AJHL, but mostly the BCHL. It's just, you look at all the scholarships, this is where all those players come from, is from this league. They move on to college. All the NHL teams, they just love that they've played in that league and they've developed in college. Mark Howe probably said it best. He was our pro director of scouting with the Red Wings. He said probably one of the worst things a kid could do is get drafted by one team, because you're stuck in that tree of priorities on their depth chart and that. When you go off to college, you become a free agent, you develop, all of a sudden you'll have 32 teams knocking on your door if you're a really good player. Aaron Volpatti, for example, when he played here, he's a perfect example of that. You know, he played here, he went off to Brown, had a great career at Brown. He had three or four teams knocking on his door. Players just take so long to get to where they're supposed to be. I'll use a school analogy. You don't jump from grade 8 to grade 12, okay? You got to go step by step by step. If you jump from minor hockey to major junior and then to pro, you got to be a hell of a player, okay? But all the rest of the players, take your time. Just go step by step.
How nice is it to see the growth of the league too? I mean, I'm sure you've tracked it. I've been in the league 9 years. Every year, more and more players are, you know, not just making the jump to college, that's sort of expected, but they're able to actually parlay it into a very tangible NHL or pro career. Even if it's not in the NHL, lots of these guys are playing professional hockey. You know, what is it that's made that more alluring? Is it, you know, what you spoke to with the 4 years of development? Or is the league sort of at a point now where more players want to go to college and this is the obvious choice to come?
To me, now this is my opinion, when you're going to college, you've got one thing in mind. Get that piece of paper. Get your diploma, get your certificate, get whatever piece of paper you need to make your career. If you can use hockey as a tool, now hockey is a tool to get to where you're going. If you can make hockey, make money from hockey, that's even more bonus. And some players can do that because you've got that piece of paper to fall back on, but if you're playing college hockey, like you've jumped from BCHL, you go to college hockey, and then you've got an opportunity to play some minor pro, or even go play in Europe. Depending on what your background is, you might have parents who have German descent. You know, with me, like I had the opportunity to go play in Germany, but back at that time it was just kind of starting, so I didn't grasp onto it like I could have. But now you've got this opportunity to get involved and go play somewhere else. If you make it, great. Lanny Gehr, you know, Ernie's son, played junior hockey here, goes over to Europe, he's still playing. I think he's 40 something now, he's still playing.
Wow.
And he's making a decent wage, but he's one of those players who was outstanding at this level. And did he fall in the right spot? Yeah, probably, but his skill and his mindset and his work ethic, that all got through for him.
Let's switch gears a little bit. Let's talk Saturday night was the 60th anniversary of the BC Hockey League, which is such a great number, and all the BCHL teams have sort of done a retro jersey of some kind, and I thought the Viper ones looked great the other night, the white with the blue, and I know the hard work that went into designing it. I know that you yourself had were sort of leaned upon as a consultant for historical accuracy. Walk us through your role in designing those jerseys and what you thought of them once the finished product was done.
Well, the Vipers came to me, Todd came to me and said, you know, what was it like back then? I'm thinking, well, I'm not quite that old, but you know what? I was back there. But I do remember my Uncle Bob Stein. He played for the original Vernon Blades when the whole league got started. And I, like I said, I remember going to their games, and I do remember their uniforms. They were just blue and white. And so they want retro. And I know you and me talked about this. Well, some people kind of poo-pooed the thing. Well, it's just a plain sweater. Retro means what it was like back then. It doesn't mean a third jersey, what you could sell. Okay, that's what retro is. And it was the old Vernon Blades jersey. It was blue and white. And the ones we had on Saturday night had Vernon on it. I thought they looked great. I thought, you know, they were modern, but yet they showed where this league has come from or where this team has come from.
Alumni, there were a few of those here on Saturday. This has been a big effort, I know, over the last couple of seasons. COVID's really, you know, wreaked some havoc on it. I know that you're a part of the alumni trying to get all of the, or as many anyway, of the people who have been here over the years. This team's got such a rich history. So many great players have been here. How have you got involved with the alumni? We talked with Eddie Johnstone as well on the radio show on Saturday and how he's been involved as well. How important is it for an organization such as this to get back in touch with a lot of those alumni as everybody tends to drift apart and some of your involvement with it?
The one thing about the Vernon team, like I said before, it was one of the original teams in the BCJHL, which is now the BCHL. When I travel all over the place, there's a lot of teams that have an alumni association. You go to their rink, they've got their pictures of their teams from years gone by and that. And I know we started this a few years back when Duncan Ray was still alive. We had an alumni club where you'd recognize some players. Now, we, you know, fast forward to just this past year, the Vipers came to a few of us alumni and we said, look, we want to start an association. And so we've got Lenny Ramponi, who's more or less the catalyst behind this, Eddie Johnstone, myself, Colton Sparrow, Dave Robinson, Aaron Volpatti, Don Klepp involved as well, just to name a few. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to start the association. Our first step is to reach out to all the players who have played. So if you're listening to this or you see this, contact the Vernon Vipers office. We want to get all these players registered because the whole purpose of it is we want to start recognizing players, start recognizing teams, help the community, because that's what, you know, the Vernon Junior A hockey team here, the Vipers, they're not just a facet on the ice. They're part of the community and they help out in that regard. So what we want to do is, you know, we'll have a golf tournament. Proceeds will go to various places like the Hospice Society or the Vernon Junior Hospital or the Vernon Jubilee Hospital. That's just a stepping stone. But right now we just want to get players registered. We want to know who you are. We want to start a database. And right now I think we're up to about 100 people right now, which is great. And we're and this goes from 1960s right up to a couple years ago. So that's what we're trying to start. We're doing little steps, and hopefully at this time next year, you'll be able to see us out in the ice or some sort of activity or some sort of thing going on.
Marty, we really appreciate the time. Thank you so much for being a part of it, and I can't wait to talk to you again soon.
I appreciate the time. Thank you.